Hello, and thanks for clicking on my talk. My name is Elizabeth Sibert, and I'm currently a postdoctoral fellow in the Earth and Planetary Sciences Department at Yale University. Today, I'm going to talk to you about a little mystery that I've stumbled upon, almost by accident, about something major that happened in the early Miocene and some of the potential paleontological and paleoceanographic implications of that finding. I should say before I start that this is my first foray into the Miocene. Most of my work has been on the Cretaceous and Paleogene rather than the Neogene, so I'm particularly excited to participate in this Miocene session to share some of these ideas and draw on the expertise of folks who have thought about and worked a lot more on this important time period in Earth's history. Mostly, I work on microfossil fish bits preserved in deep sea sediments, so-called ichthyoliths. Ichthyoliths are isolated calcium phosphate teeth and scales from sharks and ray-fin fish, and they are well preserved in nearly all deep sea sediment types due to their calcium phosphate composition. Ichthyoliths preserve a high temporal resolution record of the evolution and ecology of marine vertebrates in the open ocean, and they can reveal some incredible stories about fish, sharks, and open ocean ecosystems. Ichthyoliths fall into two broad categories: denticles, which are scales from sharks and other elasmobranchs, and teeth, which are almost exclusively ray-fin fish, although I do find the occasional shark tooth as well. The reason that I think fish are really interesting and worth studying is that they are an ecosystem proxy. The abundance of fish present in an ecosystem is a direct function of the amount and type of primary production, which is controlled by the nutrient availability, temperature, and other oceanographic conditions, which are in turn modulated by trophic transfer processes that pass that energy from the primary producers through the food web and ultimately to fish and sharks. These processes are reflected in the fish microfossil record, not only as changes in total fish abundance, but also as changes in community structure and long-term evolutionary trends in ichthyolith morphotypes. Given that fish abundance, community structure, and diversity is ultimately driven by environmental conditions, one can then flip the script and ask the question, can fish be a useful environmental proxy? Or, put another way, when there are major changes in the fish record, what can that tell us about the environment and perhaps even global climate at that time? So this is probably a figure that you all have been rapidly gaining familiarity with this fall. And I include it here to remind us that the Cenozoic has had a huge amount of variability in climate, ranging from the extreme greenhouse conditions of the early Eocene to the ice ages of the Pleistocene. And there have also been many rapid global change events, such as the hyperthermal events in the Paleogene and the pulses of glaciation at the Eocene-Oligocene boundary and throughout the Oligocene, Miocene, and more recently as well. Now, I know that this is a Miocene session. And as I mentioned, I've spent most of my research time thus far in the Cretaceous and Paleogene. So to really motivate this story, I'd like to share what got me interested in the Miocene in the first place. These pictures are ichthyolith assemblages, all the ichthyoliths from a discrete sediment sample from the Cretaceous, the Paleogene, and the near modern. In the Cretaceous, there's about the same number of shark fossils as fish fossils. Well, in the Paleogene, there's about 5 fish fossils for every 1 shark fossil, although sharks are still pretty common. However, there's something really different about this near modern assemblage, and that's that it's completely missing the sharks. In fact, throughout most of the Neogene, shark scales are incredibly rare in the open ocean microfossil record. I find about 1 shark fossil for every 100 or more fish teeth, and that's a pretty big change from what I was seeing in the Paleogene. So I wanted to figure out what was happening to the sharks, and perhaps what made the Miocene such a tough time to be an open ocean shark. I also wondered whether the transition was happening gradually as fish diversified through the Cenozoic, perhaps they were out competing the sharks, or whether there may have been a more abrupt transition at some point. So to do that, we first have to take a trip to the DSDP site 596, a red clay site in the South Pacific Gyre that has an exceptional ichthyolith record. While ichthyoliths are preserved in nearly all deep sea sediments, the slow sedimentation rates of red clays make them ideally situated for ichthyolith work, since nature, aka corrosive bottom water, has already dissolved all of the carbonates for me. I don't have to worry about destroying potentially valuable geochemical samples to concentrate my fish fossils into reasonably workable abundances. The coarse fraction of red clays is actually almost all ichthyoliths. So DSDP site 596 has nearly continuous sedimentation, and something that's really rare for red clay site, a well-developed age model based on both cobalt accumulation and biostratigraphy. I've also put a reconstruction of paleolocation for the site on this map, and you can see that the site has stayed within the boundaries of the South Pacific Gyre for its whole history. It hasn't crossed any major oceanographic boundaries in the past several tens of millions of years. That's really important for what I'm about to show you, since it means that the changes observed at this site are more likely driven by shifts in global rather than local climatic variables. So this is a figure showing two different metrics of sharks at DSDP Site 596 over the last 40 million years. The red line is shark denticle accumulation, a metric for looking at shark abundance through time, while the blue line is relative shark fossil abundance as compared to fish tooth abundance in the same samples, a metric of community structure. And either way you slice it, there's a lot of sharks in the open ocean until about 19 million years ago, when shark populations effectively fall off a cliff and disappear. This suggests that the differences in ichthyolite assemblages that I observed was an abrupt transition, likely occurring within the span of just a few hundred thousand years at most, a geologic instant in time. Clearly, there are still sharks living in the open ocean today. So the next question to answer was, is this an extinction or is this just a reduction in abundance? To get at this question, I worked with a really exceptional student, Leah Rubin, who recently graduated from the College of the Atlantic. Together, we developed a toolset to quantify shark denticle morphological diversity to investigate this event. I'm skipping a lot of details here since this isn't really a paleontology talk, but I'd be happy to answer questions during the Q&A. For the purposes of this talk, Leah and I did some paleontology magic and divided up the fossil denticles into 88 unique denticle types. And then we went through the literature of modern shark skin diversity and tried to match these fossils with modern sharks. I'm just showing you a couple of examples of both the fossil and the modern diversity here, so you can get an appreciation for what it is that we were looking at. And if we plot the occurrences of all of these denticle types through time, here denticle types are on the x-axis, and the y-axis is time from 40 million years ago to the present. Each dot represents an occurrence of that denticle type at that specific moment in time. We find that there was, in fact, a major rapid extinction in shark denticle morphotype diversity right around 19 million years ago. It's associated with a 90% reduction in observed morphotype diversity in the open ocean fossil record, and about a 70% extinction overall. For comparison, the Cretaceous Paleogene mass extinction 66 million years ago was associated with only about a 30% extinction in sharks. So whatever happened here was twice as severe for this group. Further, the majority of surviving denticle types are not actually observed in our microfossil record after the event. We only know that they survived because we have examples of them in our modern database. You might also see here on the right that there's actually two graphs of denticle abundance, one from the South Pacific that we've been looking at a lot, and one from the North Pacific from ODP site 886, another red clay site. 886 has a significant hiatus spanning about 22 to 11 million years ago, thus missing the extinction itself, of course, but it does provide a useful before and after snapshot that confirms what we observe at DSDP site 596, suggesting that this is not a phenomenon isolated to the South Pacific Ocean. So what's going on here? Losing one shark species isn't much to write home about, but losing nearly all of them in over a mere instant in geologic time suggests that something major probably happened, at least out in the open ocean, and that the sharks might be a canary in the coal mine. The early Miocene, particularly 19 million years ago, doesn't really scream major event in Earth's history to most of us, at least not from where we're currently sitting. This figure is showing the smooth global oxygen and carbon isotope stacks published earlier this year by Vesterhold and colleagues, although I could have used pretty much any Cenozoic global isotope stacks for the purposes of this discussion. I've included the most recent 40 million years here, and I've put shark abundance data below on the same time scale. This orange box is the shark extinction interval. Not much seems to be going on there. It's well after the Eocene-Oligocene transition, which is talked about as one of the major drivers in marine predator evolution. And indeed, the shark extinction seems to occur 3 to 4 million years after the Oligocene-Miocene boundary here in green, and about 2 to 3 million years before the onset of the middle Miocene climate optimum that dominates the research done on the first half of the Miocene. So nothing really stands out in this global climate stack to suggest any major global environmental shifts. Locally, there is an increase in sedimentation rate a couple of meters below the extinction event at DSDP site 596, but the timing really doesn't quite match up. It's closer to the Oligocene-Miocene boundary. So I decided to dig a little deeper and try and find some high-resolution proxy records from the early Miocene to see if I could find any clues to what might be going on. The short version is that while some records exist across this interval, they're pretty low resolution and relatively unremarkable. It seems like most folks start their high-resolution proxy records around 17 to 18 million years ago and run them through the middle Miocene, or they go across the Oligocene-Miocene transition, but stop before they reach this interval. So the middle of the early Miocene, turns out there's not much known. So I started to wonder if this was a problem of interest or a problem of preservation. Now, I'm not the first person to ask this question. Talk to any paleoceanographer and they'll tell you that the early Miocene is just kind of poorly preserved. In fact, there are a few studies by Gerda Keller and John Barron in the late 70s and early 80s suggesting that there may have been a series of widespread, if not global, hiatuses in the deep sea throughout the Miocene, including one from about 18 to 20 million years ago, spanning this shark extinction. More recently, Shannon Peters and colleagues compiled a database of deep sea carbonate sediments to look at hiatuses through time. And while there's not much about the early Miocene that jumps out in the compilation, it is possible that this little blip might indicate even poorer than expected preservation in this early Miocene interval. However, there's been a fair amount of shuffling in the early Miocene biostratigraphy over the past 50 years, and the deep sea drilling technology has improved considerably since the 70s and 80s. So I thought it was time for another pass over this question of how well this interval is preserved. Well, that, and I now have reason to think that there might be something particularly interesting about the middle of the early Miocene, and have a vested interest in finding more localities that I can get high resolution data from. So here's a map that I compiled showing every single site from the International Ocean Drilling effort since its inception in 1968 that extend deeper in time than the early Miocene. In short, everywhere that we would expect to find sediments from this interval, assuming continuous sedimentation. The colored dots are from cores where it's possible to tell if there is a hiatus and pause in sedimentation that includes this specific interval in the early Miocene. Blue means that it seems like the interval is probably preserved, while red is where it's missing. The gray dots are sites that couldn't be classified due to poor coring or poor age model constraints. And as you can see, nearly all of the dots are dark red. In fact, out of the 683 sites in the DSDP, ODP, IODP database, that extended deeper than the early Miocene, 459 of them, 85%, have a likely or confirmed hiatus that includes this early Miocene interval. If we only count the 288 sites with exceptional age models, just 36 sites seem to have this early Miocene interval, a mere 12.5%. I'd like to point out that not all of these red dots are created equal. A site with a thin layer of Pleistocene on top of Cretaceous sediments is missing this early Miocene interval just the same way that a site that has a 1 million year hiatus from 19.5 to 18.5 million years ago might be missing it. There isn't really an obvious geographic pattern to this data set, although maybe if you squint, the open ocean is slightly more likely to have a complete section than a coastal site. But really, there's a lot more work to be done here. Looking at the magnitude and range of the hiatuses, the sedimentology of the localities, and other geographic and geologic variables. And of course, the metric percentage of sites has its own biases as well. But this first pass really does suggest that there's something worth digging a little bit deeper here for. Clearly, there isn't a ton of early Miocene sediment in the deep sea. So to sum up, the middle of the early Miocene is characterized by the largest extinction of sharks known in their 400 million year long history. To disrupt such a long-standing, diverse, and important marine group, something highly significant must have happened. However, there's no obvious climatic driver, although relatively little is known about the specifics of different proxies during this interval. And there's not much sediment preserved in the deep sea record to get at that information. So really, I'd like to finish by saying that we really, really need more data. And if anyone has high resolution data through this interval of any proxy or any thoughts as to what might have caused such a major extinction in the open ocean, I'd love to chat. And I hope that I've piqued some interest in this otherwise unremarkable interval in the early Miocene. Indeed, the PETM was only really discovered because of a 50% extinction observed in benthic foraminifera across the Paleocene-Eocene boundary. That inspired geochemists to look more closely at the interval, and thus the PETM was found. Organisms are intricately linked to the environments in which they live, And sometimes they have really significant stories to tell that can reveal major changes in the Earth's system. I think the sharks are trying to tell us something, and I can't wait to figure out what it is. Thank you.